This is astronaut Victor Glover. After graduating from Cal Poly in 1999, he became a Navy pilot, flying fighter missions under the call sign Ike, short for I Know Everything. As an astronaut, he spent 6 months aboard the International Space Station. Up next, he'll be flying in orbit around the moon as the pilot of NASA's Artemis II mission. We invited Cal Poly students and professors to ask Glover their most pressing questions about space, science, and the learn by doing experience.
Great question.
This is Ask Me Anything with astronaut Victor Glover.
How are you?
I'm great. How are you doing?
Great.
Yes.
Hi.
Awesome.
I'm Dr. Samir Amin.
Very nice to meet you.
I don't usually have
uniform envy, but I mean, like, you've got pockets, and
yeah.
I mean,
I'll switch. I'll trade with you.
I'm tempted. Yeah.
I have a question for you. I've got thousands of questions for you, but I think I'll start with this one. Okay. Does food taste different in space?
Great question. Yes and no. On Earth, when you have gravity, warm air rises because it's less dense. And so what that means, when you make coffee, the steam rising off of your coffee, the warm air, you get that smell of the coffee.
Right.
Well, in space, the warm air and the cold air, even though they have different densities, they don't move without circulation, air blowing them. So what you taste is affected by what you smell.
Right.
So, for example, coffee, it's in a bag. I made coffee. I couldn't drink it for about a month because the taste without the smell, it was throwing me off.
Okay.
And one of my crewmates created a cup so that liquid doesn't fly out of the cup. It's a very narrow cup.
Yeah.
But I made it in this special cup, and then I stuck my nose in it, and then I enjoyed my first cup of coffee after almost 45 days in space. And so so it does taste different, but not because the food tastes different, because our body's response to the food is different.
I'm Chandler. I'm a... current aerospace engineering student. My first question is, what is your favorite aircraft or spacecraft that you have ever piloted, and why?
My favorite aircraft, easy, is the F-18 Hornet. So I have flown a spaceship and lived on the space station. The reason that the F-18 is my favorite of all things is because I flew it in combat. And that is just an experience that is irreplaceable.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that thing protected me. It even enabled me to protect soldiers and sailors and Marines on the ground sometimes. And that just, I will never have the privilege and the honor and the responsibility of operating another machine that does all of those things. You know, a spaceship protects you.
Yeah.
And, you know, when we're zinging past the moon in Orion, which will probably be my next favorite spaceship or thing that I've flown, you know, aerospace vehicle.
Definitely.
When we're getting kind of far away from the Earth and about 10,000 miles away, we're going to actually take the Orion spacecraft, and it's mostly flown by software. And so we're going to take it out of automatic mode and put it in, you know, fly it by hand mode. And we're going to approach the upper stage, that rocket, that ICPS I was talking about, and we're going to simulate docking to it to make sure that it's ready for the precision docking that would happen on the landing mission. You know, I'm a test pilot in the Navy.
Yep.
And being able to test fly a spaceship is just like, that's super special.
That
and so I'm really looking forward to flying Orion.
I'm David Kirby. So I'm a professor in the Department of Interdisciplinary Studies, and my area of expertise is on how science is communicated through movies and television. First question for you is, like, what is your favorite TV show or movie that takes place in space or deals with space?
You know, I really enjoyed a series called The Expanse. I actually watched the final season of that while I was on the International Space Station. I mean, I'm floating in weightlessness and watching a show about space. It's like, I love Andy Weir, period, all of his writing. The book, The Martian, the movie, The Martian, and then the book, Project Hail Mary.
Yeah.
And so, yeah, there's a lot, and it's cool that there's so much
about
space.
What are some common things you see in TV or movies that, you know, get a little bit wrong about going into space?
I would say the easiest category is just time. My first spacewalk, I was outside for 7 hours plus or minus, but I was in the suit for about 3 hours before I went outside and about an hour after. It is slow, methodic, there's a checklist, and somebody's helping you do it. In the movies, it's often very fast. You'll see people jump in a thing, they'll like pull a lever, and they always put steam in there. I don't know why there's always like steam sprayed in the room, and then they go outside into space. Then they come back in and put the lever the other way. And then they go inside, and it's like, your body doesn't work that fast. The other one, I think, is this. I may be getting into, like, controversial area here. Let me be careful I say this, but the idea of heroism or heroics or heroes, I just think that that whole narrative is challenging. Mm-hmm. They make us almost untouchable or unobtainable.
Yeah.
That's not the message we want to give kids. I'm a human and I make mistakes and I learn and I fail people and I fail myself. I let myself down. And that piece, I think, is not communicated because you make this image of this person that is just infinitely resilient and they always have something funny and insightful. And the worst situation ever could happen and they'll smile and they look good and they handle it and they do it like it was no big deal. And it's... Yeah, there's some of those moments, but often it's not that person. It was a team, somebody on the ground that you'll never know their name did it. And I just think we need to be a little more nuanced in that.
I'm Kim Bishop, and I'm a journalism professor. And one of my main areas of interest over the last decade has been the rise of misinformation and how it spreads online. And I've noticed that there is some misinformation about outer space that is amazingly persistent, such as flat Earth conspiracy. Mm-hmm. How do you feel about the persistence of that kind of misinformation about outer space?
Yeah, I will say a couple things, because this has been a conversation for 12 years since I've had this job. The fact that so many humans are focused on outer space and deep space exploration is a strength. That's a good thing. Whether we agree about things or not isn't as important to me as the willingness to engage in dialogue. That's important. And if we're willing to engage in a dialogue, to me that's more important than me convincing you or winning a conversation. And this idea of flat or round, and it's not perfectly round, it's an ellipsoid, right? It's like a tomato. And I've seen that with my own eyes. I don't really judge that perspective. I try to focus on the conversation that it starts.
Is there any piece of misinformation, like anything that is remarkably persistent that that just kind of makes you scratch your head? Like, people still talk about the moon landing and whether it was real.
Yeah, I think, you know, we're going to try to do it again soon, and so pay attention when we do it this time, and now you can judge for yourself. The ability now to use imaging technology to watch things fly into and out of our atmosphere and beyond, hopefully people can decide for themselves. Is it real or not?
Sure.
And so, hey, stay tuned for Artemis II, and then eventually when we land on the surface of the moon again, people can judge for themselves.
Yeah. You know?
Hooah. Good, how you doing?
Good to see you.
Good to see you, Roman.
Yeah, so I'm Roman, senior of aerospace. I'll be going into the reserves as an engineering officer. So how did your time in the Navy prepare you to become an astronaut?
Oh, wow. So many ways. I think there's so many transferable things. You know, there's like kind of easy things to account for. Like, I'm a pilot. I'm a naval aviator, and astronauts all fly. Mm-hmm. So there's those kind of tactical level things that transfer.
Right.
But in a bigger sense, in a strategic sense, you know, serving your country, understanding the principles, values, and ethics of a system, that to me, maybe, you know, kind of subjugating your personal to the larger, that is a huge part of going from the Navy to NASA. The International Space Station is 15 to 18 countries, depending on how you count it. Every individual crew member could be from a different country, possibly. Mm. And so we speak two languages minimum on the space station. Russian and English are spoken all the time on the space station. And then you add French and Japanese and Czech and Croatian, Hungarian, Indian. The bigger picture, not in spite of those things, but using all of those things, using the strength of all that variation. Mm-hmm. It was different in the Navy, but that same multinational effort, we do that at NASA as well.
Nick.
Welcome.
Yeah. Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you, Nick.
Nice to meet you. So I'm a kinesiology major here at Cal Poly.
Very cool.
So my first question is, did you notice any physical changes to your body from your first mission to space?
Oh, big time.
Yeah.
So because you don't have, you know, my body weight pulling down on me, I stretched out about an inch.
Really?
I was 6 feet tall for the first time in my life. I mean, I was actually taller.
That's awesome.
My spine expanded, and so while I was in space, as soon as I got back to Earth, I lost it all. Compressed right back. But your body can adapt to almost anything.
Yeah.
And so you get to space, and your body goes, oh, I don't feel my weight. This is great. And, but it starts to adapt to that. Coming back to Earth, then I had to get used to weighing 200 pounds again.
Yeah.
And so adjusting back to living in gravity was actually harder than adjusting to living in space.
Wow.
That was very surprising.
I think just another question is like, what was like your exercise regimen up there?
Great question. One of my favorite things. People always want to ask about science. Exercising on the space station was my favorite thing. It's science and engineering all together. And also the human experience, it was a big part of just what felt good. It felt normal because you're floating all day.
Yeah.
Every day, you always had sleep, you always had a midday meal, and you always had exercise.
Cool.
You get 2.5 hours every day to exercise. That sounds like a lot, but that's time to do strength training, time to do your cardio training, either the bike or the treadmill, and then time to clean up and get dressed and to start work. Cool. And so that was, I love that about the space station.
Hey, kiddo. How you doing? Good to see you. Awesome.
Nice. Very nice.
So my question to you.
Yes.
How did you deal with missing your friends and family while you were in space?
Good question. I think thinking about what we were going to do before is a part of what made it not feel so lonely. You know, we had a plan, playing games or, you know, singing songs or, you know, we're going to like watch church services.
Yeah.
It didn't feel, it's actually very strange. Like as isolated as we were, I would not use the term lonely. I didn't feel lonely. The things that I missed the most were helping you guys with homework, going to performances or track meets. And I don't know if you remember, I even had one of your sisters take a picture of her homework and email it to me so I could try to like help her with her homework while I was there. It did not work out well. It was just too tough.
Yeah.
But I didn't miss many other things. You know, I didn't miss, even, you know, I love flying. I love flying the jets. I didn't miss it. While I was in space, I was enjoying that more. But I missed some of those family events. I also appreciated that you guys were really good. Like I have a DVD or an external memory device of all the pictures and videos. Like you guys made me a Christmas song and videos of like, you know, birthday songs, all of the, like I felt included and cared about, you know, and like you guys made me feel like I was a part of it even though I was far away.
Well, Victor, it's great to see you.
It's good to see you too.
You know, Cal Poly is, I would have to say, Cal Poly proud of all that you've done.
Thank you.
But if you think back on Cal Poly, who were one or two of your, you know, those faculty members that made the biggest impression on you?
Dr. LoCascio changed the trajectory of my life. More than anyone other than maybe my parents or my spouse. And a big part of it was failing his class. I failed fluid dynamics because I did not give it the time that it deserved. Mm-hmm. And I went to talk to him, and he said something to me that I share with people today. You're not here to get a job. That's easy. You're here to learn to think. And that just shifted a gear for me. And I started to think about what I was doing as an undergrad differently. You know, I wasn't doing this for some outside entity. I was doing this because this is what I'm going to walk away able to do. Dr. LoCascio, I think, epitomizes what, even as a student, I felt. Cal Poly cares about undergraduate students. It's just hard to put that in context. I've been to a lot of different universities, and so I've been able to feel it in other places, and Dr. LoCascio changed my life.
I just want to say it's great to sit down and talk with you this morning. It's been one of the joys and honors of my life to get to know you and count you as a friend. What a blessing.
Same, Jeff. Thank you.
To learn more about Victor Glover and all of Cal Poly's alumni astronauts, check out Cal Poly Magazine's Space Issue.